report down. There you go. Welcome, everybody, to the Reality Report. This is Paul McGinley from Toledo, Ohio, along with my co-host Brian Weinstein in Bridgeton, New Jersey. It's a hot day today. It's July 7th, Saturday, 2018 at 8:21. Now, there's been a heat wave going on in England, but first I must congratulate our English viewers for a successful day for their footballers who moved past Sweden today, 2-0 in a thrilling game. They're now going into the semifinals to face Croatia.
You're here. Brian,
yeah, so Brian, unfortunately, Central England, I think, not really Central England, mostly around London, I think, has been experiencing temperatures, up to 34 degrees centigrade equals something like, what, 94 or something
well,
like
that? Well, it'll be probably in the low 30s centigrade, or somewhere around 33 would be 95, I suppose. Just kind of have a feel for that for some reason. But the weather there, I think, is going to take a turn for the worse for the next 2 weeks because it's been said that they're going to go through another heat wave. And this comes off of a year which was already difficult. I believe there were floods in England months ago, but they've already had a round of warm weather, and we're going to experience some more warm weather. So we'll be talking about that today for sure because as much as it's been warm where, you know, we've been, I mean, I'm sure it's been hot in Ohio and it's been hot in New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that usual to see these extended heat waves in England, especially at those latitudes. But
yeah, well, again, I mean, we're as we were saying, every week there's an unusual weather event we're experiencing. Last week it was in the Midwest. Now it's hit California and in England. So the weather really is on the front page of the news, and it should be.
And right on the Reality Report, we know that our Sean Dudley, I believe he lives in L.A.,
right,
has been mentioning the very, very warm weather up to 110 or 115. I think it was 94 today, which
suppose
is
incredible.
Cool. Just absolutely incredible. And we're not even at the height of the time of the summer where it's at its hottest.
So, well, how's the plants, Brian, at that kind of temperature? I mean, even if it's short-lived, I mean, what, photosynthesis is temporarily stopped, or?
Well, it definitely wanes at 104 degrees. A little, any bit over 104,
it gets starts warped to break down. In some way.
Right,
yeah.
Right. And it just gets worse. And not only that, even just with these high temperatures, look at, for example, places like Ottawa, London, and we're talking about Ontario, not London, England in this case, Montreal. These are places which have been experiencing very, very hot weather, 95 degrees, and consistently that temperature for 4 or 5 days. They just had a break recently, as did we. But those people aren't used to that kind of thing. So if you get an older person or a younger person who can't really regulate their body to those temperatures, it's mm-hmm. deadly. And they've had, I think in Canada, something like 38 deaths or 45. I don't know the amount, but it's a large number. Because they're not used to that kind of thing, we are. But even so, it's not fun. It's something where you have to stay inside because it's extremely uncomfortable. I've had discussions, you know, again, these anecdotal memories of summers past, and we've had hot summers before. We've had our heat waves, but it just seems as though it's just been consistently warmer. And it makes it very, very difficult. Today we had a wonderful day because it was in the 70s, the low 70s. And it used to be maybe 4 or 5 times during the summer, during the 60s, you'd have one of those type of days. Now it's rare. Now, we were lucky today. We had it. Tomorrow we'll have a high of 83, which I guess we'll take because it's actually cool compared to the way it's been. But those days in which we had the cooler temperatures, they're gone. And those days going back to the 1700s, when they actually maybe first started mentioning temperatures, it probably wasn't unusual to have a high in the high 70s and low 80s, where we are now near Philadelphia. But these temperatures are off the charts, and of course we'll get into Great Britain in a second. But these looping patterns of the jet stream are creating the problem because these things are so slow moving. these weather patterns, the lows and the highs, and they loop up and down and up and down. So they go very up high in the latitudes. And this is why places like Ottawa and Montreal are 95 degrees, just as hot, if not hotter than it is here. And it's unacceptable. It really, really is.
Well, I would imagine, aside from people having to take shelter, I think the major fear is what it might do to our crops, you know, right. Our grain-producing states. I think that's a great fear when it starts interrupting food production. And
right, it requires more water, too. I mean, it's kind of common sense. Mm-hmm. It's drier and you don't have as much precipitation. You're going to have to irrigate, and that requires energy. And Chris, that can get into an entire topic in itself with desalinization. But the point is that there's a great energy demand for this type of weather, and we better see it because it's going to happen.
And of course, Brian, you had to mention water. So one of the stories this week is that if anybody didn't know, Nestle, the multinational company who markets such waters as Ice Mountain, actually takes it from a Michigan spring. And they managed to get approval to increase the amount of water that they're pumping. The Michigan Department of Environmental Quality has allowed them now to pump 576,000 gallons of water each day from the White Pine Springs, which is close, pardon me, to the small town of Evert, Michigan. Now, this was opposed by 81,000 Michiganders, and only 75 were in favor. Yet, that Michigan Department of Environmental Quality allowed this.
Right.
In what I see as a craven caving in to corporate interests. Just to give you an idea of where Evert is, I'll look it up here and show it on the share screen. But how much is Nestle paying for this water? Well, there's a $200 extraction fee. There's a $2.50 charge per 1,000 gallons, which is approximate to what residents pay for water use. And that's it. Other than that, is there whatever their production costs are? If they're paying $2.50 per 1,000 gallons, and they're selling half a gallon for $2.50, easily $2.50, if not more, that is obscene profit. So basically, they're stealing the water. They're stealing the water from a state that is a Great Lakes state that happens to be blessed with a lot of water resources. We know about the publicized difficulties Flint went through when their water was contaminated. They were drinking contaminated water, and the city is now, city residents are actually living off bottled water right now, and probably in some ironic twist, probably some Ice Mountain water as well. I'm going to share a screen here really quickly just to show you where Evert is. I think there's nothing like a map really to give us an idea. So here's Evert. Now, if you just to zoom out so we can see where it stands, we can see it's in halfway between Grand Rapids and Traverse City, two better known places, okay, in Michigan. Not that far from Flint, and but it is in the southern half, not the Upper Peninsula. Now, if we zoom in, what are we starting to see? We're starting to see a lot of lakes, obviously all kinds of underground springs, and it's not a big town. It's not a big town. I don't exactly know where the spring is that they're extracting the water from, but they say it is close to Evert. So it might be somewhere around here or here.
There's Spring Hill Camp right there.
So I'm wondering.
If there's any relation.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I think the most important fact is that it's a very small town. There are not a lot of people. So the amount of resistance.
I think it was close to 7 miles, so road. So it's probably, yes, it could be anywhere. But while I've got it on share screen, I had another picture I wanted to show you. It saved it. How do you like that?
Could you blow that up just a little bit more, Paul? Is there any way you can zoom in a little bit on that photo?
Sure.
Thank you. That's good.
How do you like that? Looks like a military complex. That's one of the Nestle plants that's extracting the water. It puts it into these water carriers, trucks, and then they take it out. And, of course, it's all fenced up and so on. Fenced up to keep the local residents from their own water. I don't know. To me, this is disgusting. This is what I have a problem with America and the American system. The American way, the current American capitalistic way is that we favor corporations over human beings.
And we know why, too.
Because
it's
money.
Right, because you see the lobbyists get involved in any type of lobbyists in the sense that they're going to give money to influence. In fact, there's a nice video that Mark Anlin passed on me, which I did post on the Reality Report. So if anybody's interested, please go to the Reality Report. And if you're on YouTube, just look in the discussion section and you will be able to see a link to our Facebook page and then you can find it there. But there's a good video on how the will of the people is never satisfied through government in general. Maybe only 30% of what the public wants do they ever actually get. And that's a classic example right there. In fact, they'd be lucky if they got 30%.
I mean, you know, we've been accused here of the Reality Report of hating America and so on. I do not hate America.
Wrongly so, too. Wrongly
we live so. In America, okay? Why would I live in a place I hate? It doesn't make any sense. What I hate is the way is the direction in which America is going, that it gives greater primacy to corporations over people. You know, that you have the residents of Flint drinking shit for water. And in the meantime, this big multinational company that, by the way, is Swiss, it's not even an American company for crying out loud, comes in, steals the damn water for nothing, and then marks it up by 2,000%. How can we support that? Who are the cave people that allowed that to pass? Okay? I mean, come on. Let's wake up, people. And we got to fight this crap, you know? I mean, I know. It's just so disgusting.
Well, this is why we need to have regulations. And even with the regulations, you can see how some people who are unscrupulous. They will just – they'll give in. They'll take money. They'll take some bribes. They'll get a promise for something. And this is just the way a lot of these small towns, even large places, small towns work. You can buy zoning boards off. A lot of bad things happen when you have.
And this is why I urge libertarians, you got to get involved. You know, you just can't, right. You know, shove that blanket over your eyes.
You know, it's funny. It's interesting about libertarians, and I won't even apologize for saying this. In general, I think the libertarians are probably trying to almost be like an elitist Republican and saying we're even more so because we're into freedom and the individual.
Get detached and
right?
all that.
But on the other hand, it seems that more often than not, when you're given a choice of the Democrat and the Republican, we know exactly for whom they will vote, and that will be the Republican.
Right.
And it'll probably even be for the most conservative Republican.
But the point is, there's a reason for a government. There's a reason for regs, right? Because otherwise – corporations are going to run all over you. In fact, corporations are already running over
Absolutely.
Us. Okay,
Absolutely.
It's time to check this. Okay,
right. And
time is now. We don't have much time left. The time is now.
You know, we a lot of people have read Brave New World in 1984. I obviously would say it's more Brave New World is probably more appropriate, but a lot of people think about Big Brother. But if you think about the real Big Brother, it's really business, because they initiate what happens in government in many cases. So they're the ones that get away scot-free in a way, because people on the right at least seem to glorify the rich. Maybe because they vicariously would like to be them one day, you know, just like somebody would vicariously root for a team from their city or whatever. So I think that this is a real danger, that to think that you don't need government. And unfortunately, it's been framed in such a way that government looks as though it's the evil one. And it is in many cases, but it's not evil because they're governing or they're regulating. It's because of the opposite. It's because of the Scott Pruitts of the world and the new Andrew Wheeler, who's a lobbyist for the coal industry.
Who are in the pockets of corporations.
Right.
Absolutely.
It's just kind of obvious. I mean, if you don't figure that out.
Well, there is something that we can target, and that is overturning Citizens United. That is the absolute first step.
But as I said, I've been involved with Allied for the American Promise, which is a sister page of ours on the Reality Report. You can find that somewhere. And we have tried for the last year. I actually helped with the Facebook page for the Allied for the American Promise. And we've been targeting all over the country. It's just not Allied for the American Promise, but groups related to any group fighting Citizens United. You know, you obviously don't go after conservative Republicans because those congressmen and congresswomen are not going to change their minds. But you definitely want to target those people who are on the edge. And then the only way you're going to change them is either vote them out, or you're going to have to convince them that the constituents are going to raise holy hell. And that is where you, not you, Paul, but you, the listener, come in.
With the court turning conservative, is there a chance of overturning?
No, absolutely not, Paul. I'm glad you brought that up. I think there's no chance. See, this is where you can even buy off the courts, because everybody kind of thinks, again, if the Supreme Court is this fair group of nine, you know, people. But
I can't believe they passed that to begin with, I swear, but they did. And
so I think it was Kennedy that wrote, I think, was it? And Alex Norton mentioned that.
And Trump is due to declare his nomination for Kennedy's seat Monday. He's shortlisted a group of, I think, three. And
he's making a big deal of this, too. It's going to become an event. He wants to make sure everybody sees
it. Well, it better not be that Kavanaugh, very conservative.
Well, it may be. Because don't forget, it's a female, and they say they want to have a female there to offset the other two females to make it look like, you know, it's not an all-male thing.
I mean, corporations have us by the balls. I mean, there's no doubt about it. And we've got to somehow get this overturned. That's a first step. That would weaken them, weaken this nefarious influence, corporate influence over our daily lives, and just this daylight theft of water. And, of course, you know, I could just see the apologists saying, well, it's legal. Yeah, it's legal. There's something called legal theft, okay? And this,
but it doesn't make it ethical. Theft. That's the point.
Right. It's legal theft, okay?
I mean, look at the history of what these corporations have done. We go back to 19th century capitalism, even up till maybe this. I think maybe during the 60s and 70s you started seeing some changes. But that's about it. Corporations have pretty much ruled the roost in this country, and I don't see it now with Trump. I mean, forget about it. Everybody's been bought off. This is why Trump Incorporated is going to do so well, even though, you know, declaring bankruptcy everywhere prior to his presidency. But now he's going to make money and is making money off this thing. And why not? Because this is just the way they run things. And as one of our, I guess he hasn't subscribed to us yet, but we watched Lucy Dupree's videos, and he's talking about how essentially we have is a traitor in the office. He's sold this country out, and he sold it out.
I wonder if I can get Lucy Dupree on our show.
Yeah, we'd like to have him.
We're in the midst of contacting him now and if he'll show up. But, the unemployment report was put out on Friday showing continued job growth.
Not wage growth.
And, in fact, Trump take credit for this, we should point out that this is the 50th consecutive report of job growth. So El Trumpster had nothing to do with this. But the wage growth is stagnant, okay? I don't know. I was driving through my town today and just was town of Toledo and was musing, trying to look with an objective eye to see, am I seeing signs of growth or shrinkage or just nothing? And I'm still seeing deterioration. Passed an empty lot and it said future site of so-and-so charter school. There again, this separating of our educational options and in most cases weakening our education. It's like our people will live in a third world type of environment while you have this handful that are doing just fine and or that have all the privileges.
And don't forget, we're accepting the numbers. Now the Federal Reserve came up with this number, so you kind of want to trust them to some degree. But even that,
you talking about the jobs?
Right. Mm-hmm. And don't forget, we have 12 Federal Reserve regional districts.
I've got a cat throwing up somewhere.
Okay. He's puking at the name Trump. So, but as I was saying, for anybody who's listening, the Federal Reserve, they have all these regional Federal Reserve districts, and that number, that growth or that unemployment rate is obviously the average of all of them. But we don't know that it's happening in all areas. Now, I haven't looked at all the stats of all the different Federal Reserve districts, but I think it would be wise to think specifically where is the growth. And we know that even though there may be job growth, that the wages aren't going up. And that's never a good sign. That's not a good sign for anybody, because that simply means you have a job, but that you're not actually earning enough to survive.
I apologize, folks. Whenever you have a cat, it's about to throw up, and of course you go charging. The cat naturally seeks some kind of seclusive spot away from you, and so it ends up throwing up in a spot that you can't clean up very easily. In other words, you just make it worse.
Right. So, yeah, I was just mentioning about how the regional Federal Reserve districts, they have all their individual numbers. They put them together and they come up with an average. But it doesn't mean that all regions are doing well. And I'm not trying to poo-poo all the numbers, but I wouldn't put any faith in these numbers, because just because everybody's working doesn't mean that everybody's doing well. And it just means a lot of people could be taking jobs that aren't paying enough, and that's never good. Because as we've said in our previous video about wage slavery, then you're essentially giving up your life when you're giving up your hours and not getting paid enough. But that's an entirely different story there. So, yes, I wouldn't be too happy about those numbers. There's nothing to be proud about. I know that the president's proud of the stock market, but I wouldn't even be proud of that, because it seems like a lot of the companies are buying back their own shares right there. So we just keep going on and on and on until something has to break loose.
And I did post a story on the Reality Report page about Amazon underpaying their employees in their warehouses, while, of course, Jeff Bezos continues to make obscene amounts of money. And this is the corporate zeitgeist. We got to get used to it. That's just the way it is. I'm not saying we're going to get used to it. I don't mean that, really. We have to fight this, because it's killing our country.
Well, we've got that, and we've got a lot of different issues that are going to come up. We've been talking about the lack of regulations. We know what's happened with the EPA. It's going to be a health issue. For example, Scott Pruitt and Andrew Wheeler, they have continually worked on reducing the regs for diesel trucks. So diesel trucks moving back and forth across the country, delivering their goods. You know, that those type of fumes create great pollution. It affects our lungs. And they get a free pass, where the rest of us, you know, we have to have certain standards for cars. Although the standards for the cars are going to be reduced anyway. All the standards for mileage from President Obama are going to be reduced. So this is a very sad situation. So when we say the nation's under siege, we actually mean it. Because as Lucy Dupree said in one of his videos, we essentially have a traitor, because he's selling out to other countries. And we're getting nothing out of this. We're getting poor health, fewer regulations, the rich are getting richer, the poor are getting poor, the middle class is becoming more poor than rich, and we have a lot of hatred in the country. We have a lot of people who, you know,
a lot of division.
Right. The division is incredible, and we have a lot of dangerous people out there, and this doesn't look good. This is a difficult time, and we have a situation with the current investigation with Russia. We don't know what will happen if the president's indicted. Will be the Secret Service versus, you know, whomever to pick the president up? What will happen? Then we will have a constitutional crisis. And when you have that, again, it goes to the courts. And what are the courts going to do? Well, when you have somebody like Neil Gorsuch, you know, you essentially have somebody like Robert Bork who'll do what Nixon wanted him to do. So this is a very, very serious situation. We at the Reality Report take it seriously. And again, we're not simply spouting out real weird conspiracy theories. We don't believe in the Illuminati. We don't believe in much that isn't real. That's why we call ourselves the Reality Report. Mm-hmm. But what we're saying it's a reality today. We've been so spooked by this whole thing that some people just believe it. And
we did get a response from Lucy Dupree, who says that he's not doing well physically. He's actually in a physical rehab. He's got a lung issue going on. He says he is winning the battle, but he's going to need a few months to regain his strength. Mr. Dupree, we thank you for contacting us, and we wish you fullest recovery. Mm-hmm. And we look forward to seeing and hearing from you in the future. So we'll be in touch with you on that. Yeah, thanks for getting back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dupree. Thank you. Paul, if we could go back to climate change for a few minutes, I do want to talk about Great Britain, because this kind of will tie in with Brexit or semi-Brexit or whatever is going to happen. We do have quite a few English members of our group, and we have been talking about climate change. We talk about the heat wave that will be occurring for the next 2 weeks in Great Britain. Mm-hmm. And essentially what's going to be happening, or what is happening, at least during these heat waves, is that Great Britain has a Mediterranean climate now, or it's becoming a Mediterranean climate. We always think of Britain as this London fog type thing, or even, you know, the images you have of the London fog in movies. Well, now it's going to be hot and dry in many cases. And you're going to see all kind of strange things happening in Great Britain. And already, I believe they've seen some strange things, because the certain areas have dried out. They've seen things from the far past that they normally wouldn't have been able to have seen. But the key, I think, here is that Great Britain will not have the weather they're used to having. You have a lot of people already, immigrants or people just trying to flood into Europe, and then, of course, into England. And their problem is actually, I think, greater than our problem, because England geographically is not very, very large. But if they do get too many people coming in, and then the weather, again, it's extremely dry in the Middle East, so these people are going to go, probably they're going to go north where it's cooler, and they're going to keep going west. And you know how Germany is now. They're going to start, you know, trying to diminish their immigrant population. And people are still going to try to get it in, because, hey, look, it's a nice place, it's cooler, but it isn't necessarily going to be cooler. And here's where you have the issue. And this is essentially probably why Brexit past is that they thought that it was going to become too great of a problem. And it probably is a lot greater of a problem, say, than we have. We have an immigration problem, but not so much that it's a complete crisis at this moment. I think it's kind of overblown in the United States. It simply could have been alleviated by companies and corporations not hiring people who don't have a Social Security card that's legitimate. It just could have been done. So I kind of blame big business. But getting back to England, now that's a geographically limited area. And with the weather changes there, if England becomes a Mediterranean country, you're going to see such a change. You might see people leaving England and coming to Canada or something like that. I don't know. I'm probably getting 100
well, England's famous for those lovely green lawns. And I wonder, you know, certainly if they start heating up, they might lose some of that beauty.
They're already having fires. I know that. And that's
English weather's always been controlled, I guess, by the temperatures coming up from the ocean, the Gulf Stream.
Right. It's been warm. I mean, at those latitudes, you'd expect a lot more snow and things like that. So they don't get the snow right that you would expect. They're probably as far north as maybe close to where Moscow would be. But it doesn't matter because of the Gulf Stream. But however, if they have these looping patterns of the jet stream and they start getting the Mediterranean climate coming from the south, from places like Spain, Mediterranean, Gibraltar, all those places, the climate will change for the worse, and it will get very, very warm there, at least in the summer. And already we're seeing that. So you see that the heat waves are escalating in Great Britain, and the situation's already bad because, you know, if there's a heat wave in Britain, there's probably a heat wave all over Europe. And we know that the Middle East is parched. And again, the people keep coming in. And this is why you have problems politically, and a big reason why we have Brexit. So this is a very big issue. And I don't know where it's going to go. I really don't know. I'm sure Theresa May's trying to deal with it. But
In the meantime, we've got the season's first hurricane. It's not a strong one. It's only Category 1.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's another thing, too. You mentioned the hurricanes. If you've noticed, a lot of these hurricanes that pull off of the United States, they go out to sea and they usually, you know, peter out. But in many cases now, they're still very strong. They may not have that cyclonic feature by the time it gets to England, but a lot of times now they're getting storms where they have 100-mile-an-hour winds. So maybe it's not technically a hurricane, but if you have 100-mile-an-hour winds, you have a Category 2 hurricane, right? I mean, so what does it matter? So, I mean, I don't care what you call it. You can use any kind of semantic fiat you want. The point is they're experiencing very strange weather, which may be the norm. Strange may be the norm there. So I think that you're not only seeing climate change in Great Britain, but you're also seeing political change, which relates to the climate change, which we discuss with Guy at Infinitum in our first video with him, I believe.
Yeah, well, this hurricane, although it's not strong, I think the projected path is interesting. It's projected to go through the Lesser Antilles and through San Juan. Oh, gosh, poor Puerto Rico. It won't be affected by this storm. It's too weak. But if this is any kind of harbinger of the following hurricanes to come, I think Puerto Rico is going to get slammed again.
And they're going to get double slammed because you know that Trump won't be helping out. He'll throw a few paper towels to them, but that's about it.
Yeah. I mean, their infrastructure is already probably on rubber bands right now. Right. You know, put together by rubber bands and springs. So we'll have to see. Doesn't look good.
It certainly doesn't. And don't forget, there are many islands near Puerto Rico who may not have had a direct hit, but if they get hit, you know, places like, I mean, Jamaica, we haven't seen Jamaica been hit for a couple of years, but a major storm in Jamaica, we know that Haiti and the Dominican Republic certainly can't take those kind of storms.
No, they don't have the infrastructure to take it. You know,
and look at the storms like Katrina, the last storm we had, Harvey in Texas. This is a storm where, these looping patterns of the jet stream lasted a long period of time. So a hurricane that wasn't all that strong, it normally passes through in a day or two, and it's done, or in hours. It hangs around for 2 or 3 days, and it just gives you 5 feet of water. So this type of weather is unprecedented, but it's going to become the new norm. So for those of you who don't believe in global warming, if you can't see the change right now that's occurring, your head's in the sand, because you're going to have to get your head out of your ass, because this is what's going to be happening every single year in the future.
I don't see how it's possible not to believe in global warming when you see these unusual events every week. They're happening on a weekly basis. So I don't see how it's possible. I mean, you've got to really have your head in the sand.
Right. Well, don't forget, and you posted something which I reposted on the Rad Report about people who support Trump. A lot of these people who don't believe in global warming, and let's face it, these are the Republicans in general. Most Republicans don't believe in climate change. Most Democrats do. You'll see that these people are really think in the short term, in the day or the two, or they'll say, well, if the weatherman can't get it right for tomorrow's weather, how can you tell me what's going to happen 10 years from now? And they don't understand there's a big difference between weather and climate. I know that eventually the weather's going to get cooler in the fall. Okay, I don't know what temperature is going to be on November the 12th, but I know that it's going to get cooler. So we're talking about two different things, weather and climate, just like Guy talks about the difference between predictions and projections. And you have to really understand the English language. And apparently, these Trumpsters don't, or they don't want to know the difference. They are willing to think stupid.
Well, in truth, it's a lot easier to have an idea what's happening in the future rather than what's going to happen tomorrow. Stock market, for example, it's rather easy to look ahead, say, 6 months than it is to know what's going to happen tomorrow. There's always fluctuations. So,
right.
I have to apologize to everybody. I'm overcoming a serious illness. My voice is a little off, and so bear with me as we continue this reality.
Yes, Paul, we certainly hope you feel better. I was wondering if you were going to announce that to everybody tonight, for those of you on YouTube and Facebook.
I think it's clear my voice is off.
Paul has been struggling the last few days, and he's going to have
some surgery.
Surgery.
I've got a very large kidney stone and been overcoming fevers and such. Been in bed the last 3 days, so a little weak. But we'll be all right. The reality report will continue.
Paul has been, the last couple of reality reports, he's dealt with pain, and he's been a real trooper with this. So we hope that it just get better, Paul. We really do. So hopefully it could be 100% back. But even when you're not 100%, you're doing a good job. So don't even worry about that. So, but it's good to see you back in that. So yes, we did post something about Trumpers and how they, in essence, this person was saying, I think it was from the Daily Cause, that
These are just
basically, they're selfish people. There's no way of getting around this anymore.
Right.
And they're not very good people. These are the people, for example, there was a picture of somebody with his T-shirt that says, God is in control, don't worry. You know? I mean, I think almost everything said, every line there, every word is actually wrong.
In fact, I'd like to quote from it. It says, these are the people who press their mistresses for abortions, but who also are not vexed by abortion-providing doctors being murdered in their Kansas churches. They are Confederate flag wavers in Union states, miffed that new civil rights laws a half century ago slighted their own never-do-well families in some never-quite-describable way. These are people who are so obsessed with the thought that someone better is looking down on them that they're willing to punch whatever kittens need punching in order to prove they're at least better at kitten punching than the rest of you, and shooting giraffes and God knows what else, cruel-eyed animals. There it is in a nutshell.
Right, you know, when I read that, Paul, it was surprisingly refreshing to me, because if I was going to look at the situation at an emotional level, where I didn't really analyze every little thing about Trumpers. I'd say that that description of the Trumpers gives me a pause. It makes me think that, you know what, that's generally how I feel. And it felt good to hear that, because I wasn't the only one that was experiencing that type of description of what's going on. Because at some point, you get so sick and tired of people who say, well, there is no climate change. Again, the same people that says, if the weatherman can't get it right in a day, how can they get this thing? You know, these are the kind of people that are so sure of where they're going. The Jesus this, the Jesus that. And I'm not trying to belittle people, but, you know, this is the 21st century. And to play that type of game, that serious game that you play, it's sickening. It's like somebody, you know, right after somebody dies, somebody says, well, don't worry, you know, he'll be okay, he's with Jesus now, or something like that. You know, what a cheap way to handle somebody's emotional stress and depression for the situation.
It's a well-written article. And, I mean, you've got a problem if you're in a northern state and you're flying a frickin' Confederate flag. I mean, grow the hell up, you know?
Well, you know exactly what they are meaning when they fly that flag. I see a few pickup trucks right around here where I live with the Confederate flags, and you know they're trying to put it in your face. They're not really showing it because they care about the Confederate flag. They probably don't even know what the stars mean or when it was, you know, not used anymore, whatever. They probably don't know anything about it, but they know one thing, that people get pissed off if they see it. So they put that on the back of their truck as some type of badge of honor to get people pissed off. And what pisses me off is, I mean, first of all, having the flag is ridiculous, but it pisses me off is the stupidity and the in-your-faceness of that kind of thing. They're just there to upset you, just like Trump.
Tom Arnold says, represents an oppressive way of life that was defeated by the United States of America.
Right.
And there should be no reason to be still waving that flag
around. That was a treasonous nation, essentially, the South. It was a treasonous nation. You know, and they should have been treated as such.
But supported an oppressive institution.
Now, Jefferson Davis he wasn't executed. He should have been executed. And that's the one thing that was brought up by Lucy Dupree, is that when somebody is accused of treason in the United States, they are executed. So I wanted to know if Trump is indicted and convicted of treason, just like Manafort, well, it's enough to make people think. Yeah, they have executed people for less. Slovak, the prisoner, the only one who was executed for desertion during World War II.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they do. They execute you, you know. And even if you're the commander in chief and you're a traitor, okay. Now that, you know, it will not happen, but technically, If it was you or I who did something like that and we were a traitor, you know what would happen.
Now, Brian, what's going to happen when Mueller spills the beans? Because it looks like he's going to.
Well, that's what I say. We're going to come down to a constitutional crisis.
You can tell by his press leaks that he's going to sink.
Well, eventually what's going to happen is he's going to be indicted. I think at some point Mueller, when he gets enough information, he wants to have it so it's definite. Now, either Trump's going to be so scared that he's going to be nailed, that he'll do something crazy like get us in a war. I don't know. Yeah, I know that Trump will do something
like that.
He will be desperate. He will be like a cornered rat. He will be desperate. Now, the question is, if he feels he's going to be indicted and he will eventually be held accountable, what then will Trump do? Would he fight it legally, or will he do something just completely off the chain and have a real coup, so to speak? If he can pull that off with the Republicans, because essentially we have a coup right now, because they're all going along with them. Anybody who says that this is not a coup, just remember, every single Republican is going along with this guy for whatever the reason, you know, the deregulation, whatever. But it'll be interesting, because at some point it'll come down to the courts. And this is why I say this, the Supreme Court decision on Monday will mean a lot. And we know what he's going to do. He can choose any one of those three, and it really won't matter, because you know they'll be conservative. It really won't matter. we just know he's not going. He's not going to nominate Merrick Garland, as he should have. No, it'll be one of those three, and one will be just as bad as the next. But he'll do it to protect himself. He'll expect, at some level, he will expect any one of them to come to his aid when we go through that constitutional crisis. And because it'll be a 5-4, he'll win. And then,
now, what do you think the Democrats are going to do? Are they going to try to stall?
They can't do anything, Paul. They can stall, but they can't stall too long. I would expect they're basically raising their hands right now. I don't see anything that they're doing. It's too late. It will really be the people. It will be the people who go out there marching, who will do something. Or as Mario Savio said, you'll at some point you have to. The machine is so onerous that you'll have to lay your back on the gears and stop the machine. And that will be it. It will just have to be the people. Maybe it'll be the states. Maybe each state will decide, okay, we've had enough of this crap. We're gonna rebel in some type of way. I don't know. But we'll get a good picture in the November election. You would hope that enough poor people and people of sense will come out and vote in mass. But again, we're dealing with gerrymandering, so we have to deal with that on the congressional level. As far as the Senate, there aren't many possibilities in the Senate because most of the people who are up for a re-election are in deeply red states. So we got a problem there. And then we can't be sure what's going to happen with the Mueller investigation because Trump is so sly. Look, he doesn't want to go to jail. Look at Mueller. I mean, look at Manafort. Manafort's in seclusion 23 out of 24 hours a day. He doesn't want to be in there, but he's in there right now. Now, would Trump want to be there? We'd all like him to be there, and he probably deserves to be there. But he doesn't want to serve. He'll do anything to get out of it, and that's what worries me. He'll do anything, and he can do some things, but he's going to put as much pressure as he can on Mueller, and it will eventually come to a head. It's just a question of when. I think Mueller, again, he's taking as much time as he can to get as much information as he can. And that also goes for the Southern District of New York, those attorneys. He's got a great team behind him. So obviously Trump should be afraid because if he's done something wrong, and already a lot of people have done things wrong, he'll be in big trouble. But the question is, how far does this guy go? And I'll tell you, my personal opinion, Trump will do anything to get out of this. And that is a bad omen, especially when you have, just as you described, aptly described from that article, people who are willing to take this monster, this traitor, simply because they've had it with the other side. They're willing to deal with the lies because it somehow will benefit them. And they see, they probably even more strongly do not like us as much as we don't like them, as far as their thinking. So we're in a terrible, terrible situation. This is why we say, this country is now under siege. And bad things happen with ignorance. And when you have people who are not logical, who are completely at the emotional level, this is a very dangerous time. Maybe not tonight. But you're going to start seeing it on Monday because he's setting this thing up. As Mike Malloy said, and I suggest anybody who's seen the post that I had with Mike Malloy, he is already testing this country for fascism just by the vocabulary. When he eventually calls these people coming over the border vermin, then we know that he's like a Hitler. He's already testing it, as they are doing in Italy right now. Okay? So this is not an isolated situation. This is a very, very serious situation. And again, we are not saying this is a conspiracy like the Illuminati. This is very, very real. This is a real cancer, and this is what's happening. And I'm sure I don't want to put words in your mouth, Paul, but I'm sure you probably agree with me.
Absolutely, but I think Mueller's going to sink completely. I think his press releases have indicated that he sees himself unprotected by Trump, that Trump won't pardon him.
Which one are you talking about now?
the Mueller.
Well, Mueller's doing the investigation.
No, who's the one that's...
You're talking about Manafort. You think Manafort's going to sing?
Yeah.
Paul Manafort. Right, unless he expects the pardon. But again, he's already in trouble with the Southern District of New York. He is in jail, and he may not get a pardon from Trump, only because it might benefit Trump not to pardon him. Because if he does pardon him, I still believe he still has to... He can still be subpoenaed to testify in a grand jury, and then he can't lie. Or he could, but he perjured himself. So Trump, I think this is the way it works. If Trump pardoned Manafort, Manafort would be free, but he could then be called to testify through a grand jury, and then he sets himself up for perjury charges. And then, in any case, he would have to sing, so to speak. But will Manafort sing? I don't know. We may not need Manafort to sing, because if Michael Cohen can give good information, that's the point, Paul, and everybody.
I'm sorry, Cohen is the one I had in mind.
Okay, Cohen. Cohen's going to sing. The question is, how much is he going to sing? The thing
well,
is,
he feels unprotected.
Right, and he should feel unprotected. The question is, how much have people been saying so far? Only Mueller knows. How much did Flynn say? What did Papadopoulos say? You know, all the people who have already agreed to testify against essentially the Trump administration, we don't know what they've said. And it would really behoove Cohen to spill the beans. But I don't know. They probably have enough information from Cohen. See what I'm saying?
You know, it's funny because all these thieves, you know, once they get separated, they start singing on each other, you know?
Well, that's where evil people will do each other in, that kind of philosophy. Yeah. And there's so many people now that eventually some will sing. But again, it's something that it creates a serious situation, Paul, because if it gets to the point where people are singing, then how far does Trump go? Does he go nuclear? I don't mean literally nuclear, but how far does he go? Does he take us into a war? Does he sell out to Russia, which already seems like he's already done?
God, I hope not. I hope he doesn't do that.
Well, this is the type of man he is. Look what he has no ethics whatsoever in the world of business. Look what his corporation has done.
Yeah.
Which is a private company, too. I mean, he doesn't even let anybody else buy into it. It's his. And a lot of people feel he's a gangster in office. Essentially, he's a gangster. And we're
if he puts us in a war, who would it be? Let's think.
Well, first of all, he's already stated that he entertained the idea of first of all, going into Venezuela. So you start having these small tests. You go to Venezuela. Maybe he decides – well, first of all, he's having a trade war with people. That in itself means something.
Yeah, Venezuela's possible. I'm thinking Syria again.
He could go into the Middle East. He could start something up in the South China Sea. He could do anything if he felt that he was threatened. And then, of course, he has the domestic problem. What would happen? What could he do? Maybe not even get us in a war. Maybe start a civil war. Maybe he unleashes his 33%, the ones with the guns, and say, you know what? We're going to have the military. We're going to take over. We're going to take over these states and fuck the rest of the people. He could do that. I know it sounds crazy, but this is the norm in certain countries. This is why we had people like Mussolini, you know, Tojo, Stalin, Hitler. You know, it just because we've had kind of a normal presidency for the last 150 years doesn't mean that we have that security now, not with him. This is an incredible danger, and already it stinks. It's... Everybody who has any type of sense has anxiety right now. Every single day you hear something else that gets you upset, whether it's the news about the environment or this guy's cheating here, Pruitt, Manafort, Flynn, and then you're dealing with the senators, you know, McConnell, the Congressman Nunes. I mean, I don't even know how you can call him a congressman. He's just he's just a weasel. And this man holds office. This is what we've come to in this country, Paul. We have the just terrible terrible human beings in power positions. And then you wonder why, as you started off the show talking about places like, what is it called, Ebert, Michigan?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Where these things happen, because if they can do it at the colossal level, they can all do it at the small level, because there are people who do it. It's your neighbors who like Trump. They'll say, oh, geez, he's going to promise me this if I just let him. I'll just say on the zoning board, yeah, you can put that Walmart there. This is the way people work, and it's the rest of us who have to pay, just like we had to pay when the SNLs went under, just like we had to pay in 2008 to bail out the big banks. We're the, and you've stated this as much in many of the comments in our recent Reality Report posting. So we are all on top of this at the Reality Report, and this is not just me, not just you. It's everybody that's been posting, for the most part, knows what's going on, and everybody's upset. And that's a good thing, because what else can you be? How much can you take when you see somebody like Scott Pruitt? You know, that's something that shouldn't happen. It's bad, not good.
And then he's replaced by another clown.
Yes. Maybe he's not as bad in this, and maybe he won't take first-class flights. However, he is a lobbyist from the coal industry. He's part of the swamp. And they'll be polluting somewhere near you. You know, I'm surprised that the water up there in Michigan isn't polluted yet, where you're talking about. So, but I'm sure they'll get to that too. You know, it'll only be a matter of time, because somebody will say, okay, I'm going to make some money off that thing. And this is just crony capitalism at its worst. This is 19th century capitalism. This is just shit. This has turned into a complete and utter mess.
Much worse than anyone could have predicted, I think.
Now, this whole Trump story, and I blame also the Republicans, but I blame, as we did the last few Reality Reports, the Democrats allowed it to happen. You played this game. You know, you had to screw Bernie over, and you wanted Hillary to win because you just didn't want to see it happen. You know, and for those who don't like Bernie and say he would have given away the bank to everybody, you know what? I don't care, because what would you rather have, the rich guy or what Bernie's going to do? Maybe it would have been unreasonable to think that everybody could go to college for free. That's fine. You can think that. But you know what? At least he's in control, not the guy who's going to take the last cent you have.
And when the same amount of funds is directed that would send everybody to college is directed into the military, I mean, you could see such things are possible. But, yeah, I mean, when the Democrats failed to support Bernie, basically what they were supporting was this long secular drift.
Absolutely. Right. They failed us. The Democratic Party failed its own.
They saw Hillary
people
coming in and continuing that damn rightwards move or centrist move on the part of the Democrat Party. They're just disgusting.
And we still may have that, because some of them will say, Paul, look, if you want to win in 2020, you're still going to have to be centrist, because you're going to need that vote in the middle. And maybe that's true. Maybe we are so screwed up in this country that you have to have a candidate who's not as good to simply win an election. And that's pretty bad. So I don't know, but I don't like what I see right now, and I'd rather have the liberal candidate, as you say, Paul, the progressive candidate. And I hope that Ocasio-Cortez is part of a new movement to the left, because the left is better than the right. Look, in my 58 years, I've seen most of the good things that have happened have come from the left. I mean, we even got Social Security. Essentially, we got it from Eugene Debs.
Right.
It wasn't really from Franklin Roosevelt. So all of the things that have protected society, whether it's the unions, you know, to have your weekends off or you have your 8-hour day. Now, this did not come from the right. We would all, if we didn't have unions, if we didn't have the progressive wing of the Democratic Party, I'm sorry, we'd all still be pulling rickshaws up Main Street. And that's
yeah,
just
24/7, by the way, we'd be doing it.
Right. And you know what? We may be going back to that if we can survive climate change. So, you know, but the good thing about climate change is they'll all go. So if we do have that warming event that Guy talks about soon, nobody will like the pain of it and all, but you can look at those people and you'll say, look, you know, you're going through hell right now, and so am I, but at least I've been through it before.
Yeah, humanity wasn't hitting in the right way anyway.
Yeah, maybe better nothing than something at some point. I mean, if I knew that this world was going to be a Trump world for eternity, or at least for the rest of the time with the human existence on Earth, I would say forget it. This thing's got to be over, because it's bad enough as it is. Because I almost have come to that opinion right now. It's just such a vicious existence. But that's another entirely different story. But anything dealing with Trump, if it were going to be like this, I'd say forget it. Out now. You know, you can push the button, because this guy is out of control.
Mm-hmm. And well, we've done our hour, and right. I'm sorry, I'm not at my best right now. So.
Well, we hope you get better, Paul.
Sign off. And
I wanted to say one last thing here. Is that just remember, we at the Reality Report, we're not the crazy ones. We are not the crazy ones. You're not crazy. You're right. The Trumpers are crazy. They're sick people. There's nothing wrong with us. We're doing the right thing. If anything, we're conservative. We don't go off even more. So I just wanted to say that.
Agreed. Well said. So for Brian here at the Reality Report, we're signing off this Saturday. Have a good weekend, folks.
Have a nice week.